Hello everyone, welcome to this video. So since five videos, we were discussing about properties of the Riemann-Stiele integral, right? So now we shall introduce a new function called a unit step function, and we shall see some of the applications of it. So first of all, shall see what is a unit step function. The unit step function on the real line R is defined as follows. So it is basically a real valued function of a real variable defined as I of x is 0 for all x less than or equal to 0, and I of x is defined to be 1 if x is positive. So if we draw the function graph, so this is x-axis, this is y-axis. So if I mark the domain points along x-axis, then for all negative real numbers and 0, so I of x, that is y, is also 0. So these are the images. So this is the function curve. So it lies exactly on the x-axis until 0, because for all negative numbers and for 0, image is once again 0 only. But for any positive real, it takes the value 1. So this is the function curve for the step function I of x. So there is actually a break here. So this function starts from here like this. So up to 0, it ends here. Next, after 0, for all numbers after 0, the image is 1. So basically, it is not a continuous function as it is discontinuous at 0. So this is the function curve. Right? Now, for any real s, we define I of x minus s. We consider I of x minus s, right? So for all x less than or equal to s, so x minus s is less than or equal to 0. So if I consider x is less than or equal to s, all these numbers will be less than or equal to 0. And for all less than or equal to 0 numbers, image is 0. And similarly, if I consider all those x with x greater than s, then x minus s will be positive. That means these numbers will be positive. And for positive numbers, the unit step function is 1. So that is for any fixed s belonging to R, so we have defined I of x minus s. So as x varies over all numbers less than or equal to s, x minus s will be less than or equal to 0. That is, for all numbers which are less than or equal to 0, I of x, unit step function is 0. So x minus s will be 0. I of x minus s will be 0. If I assume x is greater than s, x minus s will be positive, right? So I of x minus s will be 1. So this is the idea of unit step function. So now, based on this, we shall prove our result. So the result is that f be a bounded real valued function on the closed interval a comma b, and s is any point in between a and b. If f is continuous at s and alpha of x, so alpha is taken as the unit step function I of x minus s on the closed interval a comma b, then we have to prove the Riemann-Stiele integral of f over the closed interval a comma b with respect to alpha is f of s. So this is what we have to prove. So we shall start with the things which are given. So given f is a bounded real valued function on the closed interval a comma b, and s is any point in between a and b. Also, so alpha is given to be, so what is alpha? Alpha is the unit step function x minus s. So for every x in the closed interval a comma b, alpha of x is taken as I of x minus s. And how it is defined? So for all x in this interval with x less than or equal to s, I of x minus s is 0. And for all x in this interval with x greater than s, I of x minus s is 1. So just we are using this idea, right? Okay. So then you can observe that. So alpha of x will never decrease. It is constant up to, so if I consider the closed interval a comma b, somewhere in the middle s is there. So for all points in this interval up to s, alpha is 0. And after s, alpha is 1. So up to s, it is constant, equal to 0. And after s, it increases to 1 and it goes constantly. So we can observe that alpha never decreases. It is constant. It is either constant or it will increase. So it is never decreasing. So we can consider it as a monotonically increasing function. So note that alpha is a monotonically increasing function on the closed interval a comma b, right? So now we got a monotonically increasing function alpha on this closed interval, and already we have a bounded real valued function on this closed interval. So now we can talk about the Riemann-Stiele integrability of f with respect to alpha. So we shall discuss the Riemann-Stiele integrability of f with respect to alpha, and we shall show that the integration is equal to f of s. So now we shall start with the assumption f is continuous at s. So assume f is continuous at s. Right? So now to talk about the Riemann-Stiele integrability, we need a partition. So I'll consider a partition. Consider any partition P with 4 elements. So x0, x1, x2, x3 of closed interval a comma b, right? So we know that any partition of a closed interval a comma b means what? It is a finite set of points from a to b. So now I'm considering 4 points from a to b such that, so by default, so the first point should be obviously a. I choose the second one to be s, and third one to be b. Now I'll leave the choice for x2, which has to be in between x1 and x3. That is, it has to be in between s and b. So this is like this. So I'm considering a partition of the closed interval a comma b. So x0 is a. So the s which is in between a and b is taken as x1, and I'll take b as x3. So in between s and b, choose any point x2. So here x0, x1 and x3 are fixed. So these three points are fixed. So the only point which is varying is x2, and x2 is free to choose between x1 and b. Okay, now with respect to this partition, the closed interval a comma b can be divided into three sub intervals, x0, x1, x1, x2, x2, x3. So as f is given to be bounded on the closed interval a comma b, it will be bounded on each of the sub interval. That is, f of x values will be bounded on each of the sub intervals. So as f of x values are bounded, so by the least upper bound property and the greatest lower bound property, infimum and supremum exist. So we shall define them. Let mi be the infimum of all f of x as x varies over any subinterval xi minus 1 xi, and capital mi be the supremum of all f of x as x varies over the closed interval xi minus 1 xi. So define it to be for all I. So here I varying over, so how many subintervals are there? 1, 2, 3. So I takes the values 1, 2, 3, Right. So we got the infimum and supremum. Next, we shall consider the lower Riemann's dilation and the upper Riemann's dilation. So now consider LPF alpha. So how we define it? It is defined to be summation small mi into delta alpha I running from 1 to 3 f, because the with respect to the partition P, the closed interval a comma b is divided into 3 subintervals. So there will be 3 terms in this summation. So what are those? So m1 into delta alpha 1, m2 into delta alpha 2, plus m3 into delta alpha 3. So in general, what is delta alpha I? It is alpha of xi minus alpha of xi minus 1. So m1 into delta alpha 1 means it is alpha of x0 minus alpha of x1 plus m2 into alpha of x2 minus alpha of x1 plus m3 into alpha of x3 minus alpha of x2. Sorry, this first one is alpha of x1 minus alpha of x0, right? So now here we note that x0 is less than x1, which is yes, which is less than x2, less than x3, right? So now m1 into, so what is alpha of x1? So as x1 is equal to yes, so refer the definition of alpha of x. So for all x less than or equal to yes, alpha of x is 0, right? So recall that. So we have alpha of x to be equal to 0 if x is less than or equal to yes, and it is 1 if x is greater than yes. So based on this, so m1 into alpha of x1, so x1 is nothing but yes, so that is x1 is equal to yes, so alpha of x1 will be 0 minus alpha of x0, so x0 is less than yes, so this case holds, so alpha of x0 will also be 0, plus m2 into alpha of x2. Alpha of x2 means as x2 is greater than yes, so alpha of x2 will be 1 minus alpha of x1. X1 is nothing but yes, so alpha of yes, so it will be 0, plus m3 into alpha of x3. As x3 is greater than yes, alpha of x3 will be 1 and alpha of x2. So as x2 is greater than yes, alpha of x2 will also be 1. So this will be 0. And this will also be 0. So what we are remain with? M2. So that is, we got the lower Riemann's dilation LPF alpha to be M2. And what is M2? So this is MI in general for I is equal to 1, 2, 3. So put I is equal to 2. So put I is equal to 2. M2 is infimum of f of x as x varies over x1, x2, which is infimum of all f of x as x varies over x1, x2. So that is infimum of all f of x as x varies over x1 is nothing but yes, x2. So call this as equation 1. Similarly, consider the upper Riemann's dilation. So once again, it is defined as capital MI into delta alpha I running from 1 to n is equal to 3 here, right? So 3. So now it is capital M1 into delta alpha 1, capital M2 into delta alpha 2, plus capital M3 into delta alpha 3. So it is M1 into alpha of x1 minus alpha of x2, sorry, x0, plus capital M2 into alpha of x2 minus alpha of x1 plus M3 into alpha of x3 minus alpha of x2. So with the same idea, so m1 into, so alpha of x1, x1 is equal to s, so it is 0. As x0 is less than x1, that is s, it is also 0, plus m2 into alpha of x2, as x2 is greater than s, alpha of x2 is 1, and x1 is nothing but s, so alpha of, that is 0, plus m3 into alpha of x3 is 1, alpha of x2 is 1. So what we are remained with, so it is just equal to capital M2. That is, we observe that UP of alpha is M2. And what is M2? So by our definition, M2 is supremum of all f of x as x varies over x1, x2. Or it is supremum of all f of x as x varies over s, x2. So call it as equation 2. Now as s belongs to s, x2, so f of s. So observe that. So what is m2? M2 is the infimum of all f of x as x varies from s to x2. That is, m2 is the greatest lower bound for all f of x as x varies from s to x2. So now if I put x is equal to s, so m2 is a lower bound for it and capital M2 is the supremum for it. So we get f of s is greater than or equal to M2 and less than or equal to capital M2. So now which is true for any partition P with four elements such that x naught is nothing but A, which has to be less than x1, which is S, which is less than x2, which is less than x3, which is B. So if we consider any partition with four points of this kind, the above argument holds. So the argument which we have done is true for any general partition with four points in this way, right? Okay, now we observe that since f is continuous at s, so what we observe is, now as x2 approaches s, so what is x2? So we are in the partition x0 is equal to a, x1 is equal to s, x2 is in between x1 and x3. Now bring x2 closer and closer to s. So as I told earlier, so to construct any partition of this form, so x0, x1 and x3 are fixed. They are a, s and b. So the only freedom here is x2. You can choose any x2 to construct a partition of this form. So you are free to choose x2 between x1 and b, that is x1 and x3. Now bring this x2 arbitrarily closer to s. As x2 comes closer and closer to s, yes, so for all points x varying over the closed interval s, x2, so all these points will also come closer and closer to s, right? So this is one closed interval, s, x2, which is a subinterval. As x2 comes closer and closer to s, the points of this closed interval also come closer and closer to the point s. So as x comes closer and closer to s, as f is continuous at s, f of x also come closer and closer to s. That means As x2 approaches s, the points in the closed interval s, x2 will approach to s. So that is all the points in this closed interval will approach to s. So that corresponding images all will ultimately approach to f of s. So all these points ultimately approach to f of s. So as I bring x2 nearer and nearer to s, all these f of x values are nothing but converging to f of s. So what could be their infimum and supremum? Then so infimum of f of x as x varies over s, x2, so which is m2. So what could be this? So as I bring x2 nearer and nearer to s, so these f of x values are nothing but approaching to f of s. So their infimum values will be nothing but, the infimum will always obviously approach to f of s. So as all f of x's are approaching to f of s, so the infimum will also be approached to f of s, right? And similarly, the supremum. So supremum of all f of x as x varies over the closed interval is x2. So as I bring x2 nearer and nearer to s, so all these x's are approaching to s. F of x's are approaching to f of s. So the supremum will approach to f of s. As all f of x's are approaching to f of s, their supremum, its supremum should also approach to f of s. So since f is continuous at s, we observe that m2 will approach to f of s, and capital M2 will also approach to f of s, which is true as x2 approaches s, right? Okay, next. Now I'll consider mu be the class of all partitions of above kind, right? So the odd partition which we considered earlier, so we considered a partition with 4 points where 3 of them are fixed, only x2 is varying. Now choose all possible values of x2 between x1 and x3, then you will get all possible partitions of this kind and put them in the class mu. So mu is the collection of all such partitions. Then what we can observe, right? So now to consider or to get the elements of mu, what we have to do? So we have to construct all possible partitions of 4 elements where 3 of them are fixed, right? So you have to construct a partition where x0 is A, x1 is S, x3 is B. So the only thing varying is x2. So x2 can take any possible value between x1 and x2. So as x2 varies over the range x1, x3, we get all possible elements or members of mu, right? So as I vary x2 over all the values in between x1 and x3, so you'll get all possible partitions of such a kind, so which are nothing but the elements of mu, right? So now what I'll do is just I'll arrange the elements of mu in the decreasing order of x2. So I'll start choosing x2 very closer to x3, right? So this is the interval AB. So where this is x0, this is x3, x1 is S, and I have to choose x2 now between x1 and x3. So start choosing x2 to be very closer and closer to x3. So start from the right hand. So start choosing x2 from the x3 end. So untend x2 to yes. So I'll start choosing x2 from the x3 end. So for every choice of x2, you will get an element of mu. So in this order, I'll place the elements of mu. Okay, so what happens if I choose x2 in such a way? So how will choose? So choosing x2 from x3 end and tending x2, yes, right? So I'll start choosing x2 from the right hand, that is x3 end, and I'll come closer and closer to yes to choose all possible x2 values, right? So what happens? So choosing x2 from x3 end and tending or coming closer and closer to yes, we observe that, right? So for every choice of such x2, for every choice of such x2, you will get a partition P with four elements so that we can calculate the lower Riemann Stiele sum. And the discussions which we made till here as the partition P was arbitrary, so we observe that for any such partition LP of alpha is always M2 and UP of alpha is always capital M2, right? So for any such choice of partition P, so LP of alpha is always M2, and what is it? It is the infimum of all f of x as x varies over yes x2, right? So now what this infimum becomes as I bring x2 nearer and nearer to yes? So once again, x2, x0 is a, x3 is b, x1 is yes, and x2 is somewhere here. So now as I bring, suppose x2 is here, so this will be the close interval yes x2, right? Now if I choose x2 here, now suppose as I coming nearer and nearer to yes, so if this is the next value, so this will be the interval sx2. So note that as x2 approaches yes, the interval sx2 becomes smaller and smaller. So this was the initial interval, so after next choice of x2, the interval became smaller. So observe that this bigger interval is contained in this interval. So infimum of f of x values as x varies over this interval will be greater than or less than or equal to infimum of f of x as x varies over this interval. Suppose if I assume the bigger interval as say I1 and smaller interval as I2. So note that if A is contained in B, infimum of A will be greater than or equal to infimum of B. Now observe that interval IN contains interval I2. So now if I take infimum of all f of x as x varies over the interval I1 and infimum of f of x as x varies over the interval I2, so as I1 contains I2, so this infimum will be less than or equal to infimum this. That is, as the set becomes bigger and bigger, as the interval becomes smaller and smaller, the infimum value becomes larger and larger. You can observe here. So I1 contains I2, that is I1 is bigger than I2, but infimum of f of x as x varies I1 will be less than or equal to infimum of f of x as x varies I2, as I1 is less than I2. So as the interval becomes smaller and smaller, the infimum value becomes larger and larger. So that is, as I bring x2 nearer and nearer to yes, so this infimum value becomes larger and larger. That means LP of alpha is becoming larger and larger. So which goes on increases as x2 approaches yes, such that so it never exceeds f of s, right? So m2 is always less than or equal to f of s, and finally m2 is approaching to f of s, right? So this is what we are observing, right? So as I tend x2 to s, the interval becomes smaller and smaller. The interval s x2 becomes smaller and smaller. So the infimum of f of x taken over s x2 becomes larger and larger. It becomes larger and larger. So LPF also becomes larger and larger. It is gradually increasing. It is gradually increasing. And these values, that is LPF alpha equal to m, these are gradually increasing, and at most they are approaching to f of s. So what could be the f of s then? F of s has to be the maximum value of LPF. So then f of s has to be supremum of LPF as p varies over the partitions of close interval a comma b with four points as we discussed here, right? So as I tend x to s, we get f of s to be the supremum of LPF alpha as p varies over mu. Similarly, as x2 approaches s, as x2 approaches s, we observe that. So once again, for every choice of x2, you will get a partition. So with respect to each partition, you can define UPF alpha. And for every such partition UPF alpha, we have showed that it is equal to M2, which is the supremum of all f of x. Supremum of all f of s as x varies over the interval x2. Now, as I bring x2 nearer and nearer to s, the interval sx2 becomes smaller and smaller. And you observe that whenever a is contained in b, supremum of a is less than or equal to supremum of b. That is, as the interval becomes smaller and smaller. So, for example, once again, I'll illustrate that. So what I'm doing, so x0 is a, x3 is b, x3 is b. So x1 is s, and I am free to choose x2. Now, suppose this is x2, so say this is interval I1. Now I'll bring x2 somewhat closer to s, so this interval becomes smaller, call this smaller interval as I2. So the bigger interval is I1, smaller interval is I2. So now consider supremum of all f of x as x varies over the smaller interval I2, and supremum of f of x as x varies over the bigger interval I1. So as I2 is smaller than I1, supremum of f of x over I2 will be less than or equal to supremum of f of x over I1. That means as x2 approaches s, the interval sx2 becomes smaller and smaller, so the supremum value becomes smaller and smaller, so which goes on decreases. So what happens? So as x2 approaches s, we observe that UPF alpha is supremum of f of x as x approaches s2, which goes on decrease such that, so it never goes below f of s, right? We have seen f of s is less than or equal to m2, and m2 is approaching to f of s. So what it means, so as x2 approaches s, the interval sx2 is becoming smaller and smaller, so that the supremum values are becoming smaller and smaller. That means UPF alpha. So UPF alpha is gradually decreasing. It is decreasing, and finally it is approaching to f of s. So what it means, f of s has to be the smallest value among all u of UPF alpha. So it has to be a lower bound for all these numbers. So UPF alpha is nothing but m2. So M2 is gradually decreasing. It is decreasing, 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 and finally it is approaching to F of S. So what it means, the values are gradually decreasing and it will approach to the smallest possible value, so that F of S will be lower bound for UPF alpha. That means F of S will be minimum possible value of UPF alpha. So therefore, so F of S will be nothing but so lower bound, that is greatest lower bound of UPF alpha, as P varies over the partitions of mu. So this is what we observe. So the discussion which I made inside the brackets, it is just for the understanding purpose. So now, just I'll write the result directly. So if mu is the class of all partitions of above kind, then we observe that supremum of all LPF alpha as P varies over mu is equal to F of S, which is equal to the infimum of all UPF alpha as P varies over the partitions of mu. And the reason behind this statement is in brackets, so which we have discussed till now. Okay, right. So ultimately we got what? This one. So supremum of all lower Riemann stellations is equal to F of S, which is equal to infimum of UPF alpha as P varies over mu, right? Now we shall start with let script P be the set of all partitions of closed interval a comma b. Then mu will be contained in P, because mu is what? Mu is collection of some special type of partitions of closed interval a comma b, which contains only 4 points, right? So what is mu? Mu is the class of all partitions of above kind, where we considered partitions with 4 points. So mu is collection of some special type of partitions of closed interval a comma b, and P is the class of all partitions. So whatever the possible partitions of closed interval a comma b are there, all those will be in P. So mu will be contained in P. So this is one observation. So now consider, so F of S, so which we observed, it is equal to supremum of LPF alpha as partition P varies over mu, or it is also written as supremum of all the numbers LPF alpha where P varies over the class mu. Now consider the set of all LPF alpha, so where P varies over the class of all partitions of P, right? So as mu is contained in P, so that is this set is contained in this set. So supremum of this set will be less than or equal to supremum of this set. So this is because mu is contained in P. So as mu is contained in P, so this set is contained in this set. So supremum of this set will be less than or equal to supremum of this set. So just I am using here, whenever A is contained in B, supremum of A is less than or equal to supremum of B. So it is nothing but supremum of all LPF alpha as P varies over all possible partitions of P. So which by the definition, it is nothing but what? It is the lower Riemann Stiele integral of F with respect to alpha. But lower Riemann Stiele integral of F is always less than or equal to the upper Riemann Stiele integral of F. And how it is defined? It is infimum of all UPF alpha as P varies over all the partitions of P. Right? Now, what is it? It is the infimum of all the terms U, P, F, alpha, where P varies over the partition. P varies over all possible partitions of close interval A, comma B. On the other hand, consider U, P, F, alpha, where P varies over only the class mu, where mu is contained in P. So as mu is contained in P, so this set contains this set. This set contains this set. So infimum of this set will be less than or equal to infimum of this set. So that is, whenever A is contained in B, infimum of A is greater than or equal to infimum of B. So this set is contained in this. So infimum of this set is greater than or equal to infimum of this. So what is it? It is nothing but infimum of all U, P, F, alpha as P varies over the class mu. And we have showed it to be equal to F of S. So now we made a list of arguments here. We started with F of S. It is less than or equal to supremum of LP F alpha as P varies over all partitions of P. That is, it is less than or equal to the lower Riemann Stiele integral, which is less than or equal to the upper Riemann Stiele integral, and which is in turn less than or equal to F of S. So that is, F of S is less than or equal to supremum of LP F alpha as P varies over all partitions of P is less than or equal to infimum of U P F alpha as P varies over all partitions of P, which is less than or equal to F of S. That is, F of S is less than or equal to, so this is nothing but the lower Riemann Stiele integral of F, which is less than or equal to the upper Riemann Stiele integral of F, which is less than or equal to F, which implies, so what it implies? So observe that these two numbers lie in between the same numbers, F of S. So it shows that these two numbers are equal and it is equal to F of S. So which implies the lower Riemann Stiele integral of F is equal to the upper Riemann Stiele integral of F is equal to F of S. So as the lower Riemann Stiele integral is equal to the upper Riemann Stiele integral, so thus or therefore we can say F is Riemann Stiele integrable on the closed interval A comma B. And further, so whenever it is Riemann Stiele integrable, the common value of these two is taken as the Riemann Stiele integral and it is equal to F of S. And the common value is taken as the Riemann Stiele integral and it is equal to F of S. So we got it to be F of S. So which completes the proof. So in this video, we introduced unit step function and we discussed an application of unit step function.